everybody. My name is Blake Hamilton. I'm a history and geography teacher from Corindai High School. This little video is a bit of a how-to guide about how to tackle doing your own panic or escape room that's portable and sticks to your syllabus dot points. A lot of the comments that I've seen have been overwhelmingly positive, and I thank you a lot for that. It's really good to see that people find that this is perhaps something that they want to tackle and take on board. But it maybe is a little bit overwhelming. You might have heard about escape rooms and not really sure if you can go ahead and create one yourself. So this is just a little bit of a how-to guide, I guess, to get started, to start thinking about it, if you're going to do it individually or as part of a team. So the first thing that I would suggest is that no matter what subject you're teaching, it can be a senior, a junior topic, whatever, have a look at your syllabus dot points first. That's a good little guide or a good little checklist for setting out from start to finish what is the context for each of your clues going to be. It doesn't necessarily have to be the answer to your puzzle to keep going. What I mean by that is that one of the first syllabus dot points that I would like my senior students to be able to revise over for looking at power and authority is understanding the treaties, specifically the Treaty of Versailles. Now, I didn't come up with a puzzle where they needed to know all the terms of the Treaty of Versailles to move on. That would be a little bit hard. It doesn't really come into a like a number form or a letter form, which I can then put onto a lock that they can crack to keep going. But what it does is it sets the context. So all I've done is, this is not a copy of the Treaty of Versailles or anything like that. I've just done up a little mock prop here, Treaty of Versailles, German terms, and I've listed three of the German terms, which I think would be important that if they were able to lock that away into their long-term memory and write about it during the HSC, that would be a great piece of evidence. But most importantly, the start of each of these terms that I've highlighted, it's a larger letter, it's capitalized, and it's in bold. So what they should be critically thinking about is what stands out here. It's the SUL. They can have a look around the room, have a look at all the locks, and there is a letter combination lock over here that when you put in SUL, they get to open the lock, and the locks are important. This is like the gamification of the whole thing, this little endorphin hit. There's some really good studies about, you know, what keeps kids coming back to these video games and these challenges over and over again. It's that little reward, that endorphin hit that they get when they solve a puzzle, and it really helps kids to persist with hard challenges that are not straightforward. So I can give an example, something like that Treaty of Versailles puzzle. You could have a group spend 10 minutes on that first one. They can't move on to anything else until they figure out that first one. They're getting stressed, they're looking around the room, but when they finally get it, it's like they're reinvigorated again. They hit the NOS and they keep rocking and rolling. Then you can move to your next puzzle. And again, this is something a little bit different. We have our source here where I want them to be able to memorize who the big four leaders were during the Treaty of Versailles. I've got their names listed out there. They haven't had to remember that. But I have got the flags of each of the countries, a map over here with numbers listed over countries all over the world. That gives you a four-digit combination lock, which then you can move on to the next one. Other things that you might be able to use are simply just going to the photocopier, printing off pictures of, say, famous figures, putting them in cheap photo frames, and then you might have like a clue or something on the back, okay, that they can come up and flip around, kind of like a fun house. Or we had this collection of lovely old newspapers just sitting around in the school archives that are actually about the war, but inside photocopied some more selective text. So here's one about Rudolf Hess and his plane crashing, or here's one about the Soviet non-aggression pact being broken, and that will contain clues. So as they're like searching through, they'll find these little scraps of information to keep them going. It's important that the puzzles are accessible for anybody. Even if you don't know anything about the topic, it should be that if you know the content, you can move faster through the puzzle. There's the reward. If you don't know, it's going to take you longer, but you shouldn't be completely stomped out. Okay, you're not going to get people to persist that way. So one of them asked about matching certain leaders to their ideology. So Stalin, communism, Tojo, militarism, Mussolini, fascism. This can be hard for people to remember. So you might have laced around the room, underneath say a bottle or in a drawer or underneath a pillow or something like that, just little hints. Here I have a picture of communist leaders in the Soviet Union ending with Stalin, and his name appears, and just a little bit of a hint to socialism, just as like a spark to remind some people. You can be a little bit more obvious than that, where this picture here with Mussolini, it just has Mussolini and fascism. Now, I haven't gone ahead and given clues for three out of the three. If they're able to work out what those two are, then the last one remains. So you don't have to hit people over the head and completely undermine your puzzles, just enough that people are able to move forward and access the puzzles, even if they're not an expert, okay? We want them to be able to persist. The next thing would be, okay, how do I actually build this thing? I've come up with all the puzzles. So you're gonna have to take a trip to Bunnings, because most importantly, are the locks. Now, this will be something you have to talk about in your faculty, about sourcing locks as part of your budget. I suggest that you just get the really cheap travel locks and get a bit of a mix and match, depending on what your puzzles were and such. You can get some four-digit locks, you can get letter locker locks, like that, which are good. They come set with what their letters are, so just be careful. You can't really set them to whatever you want to be, like the cheap one anyway. And little cash boxes. Now these are great for, you know, hiding in a drawer or something like that. I have done some drawers here, and I'll explain how you're able to put these little latches on. But you get these little cash boxes, they're about 10 bucks each. And on them is a little $2 latch. Okay, so just give me a second, we'll open that up and take a bit of a look. Open that one up, it'll look like this. Latch comes down, it's a simple loop where I've just drilled in the top part here and the latch, and again that's $2, that opens up. There can be another clue in here, this one's a certificate, and the best part about those is that it also has a little tray so you can hide secondary clues in there to make sure that they're not rushing. So here I've got a piece of Nazi gold, which I've 3D printed. Again, most schools have 3D printers, so that's a good excuse to go over to your tech department, to have a little bit of a look at what's accessible there. They might have, you know, like laser etching, or your woodwork department or your metal department. Work with them, see what they can come up with. And again, it might be really hard to read what the clues are here on this piece of gold, but even just drawing something like a little bit of a symbol here matches up to a map, if they're paying attention, for them to work out and do a grid reference activity. So we're bringing a little bit of geography into this as well. And again, it's not pointed out what it is, but you put subtle clues for them to work out, okay, I can see that there's some grid reference going on, it's not being given to me, I need to work out what it is by following the pattern that is already available. You might have seen in the original video that I've got this lovely writing desk, a whiskey bottle, and also like a rug and like an old chair. Now, we're not all going to be able to access all that sort of stuff. A lot of those are family heirlooms or gifts that I've gotten from people to be able to use for this activity, and that was really lucky. But try to source what is local. Try to just go to your local Vinnies, things just like a set of drawers that you haven't got to worry about having to screw little locks onto or putting little compartments in. That is perfectly fine. Another cheap and ineffective way of trying to set a bit of an atmosphere is music and sound. This track that's just playing at the moment, just like war sounds while they're down in the bunker, is just like an audio loop that's happening on YouTube. I gotta wrap up because it's getting pretty close to the roll call, but I just want to say that this will take a lot of trial and error, but is really fun and really rewarding, and if you're doing it with your staff members, you might actually do a lot of learning about how you approach like your lessons and the content through this. Okay, so don't expect to get clues right the first time. I have found through trial and error that people, just through curiosity, will brute force their way through finding certain things. And what I mean by that, for example, is that one of my clues lead them to open up a pillow, and inside the pillow is another clue. Here I've got a Star of David. And yesterday when I was running the activity, if you have a group of five kids and you have about three of them focusing on the main puzzle, you just have one kid, you know, wandering around, getting a little bit bored, want to do something, checking stuff, and they use that sense of touch and they're like, oh, something is in here, brute forces the way through the puzzle, but that's okay, because then you can explain at the end, you know, why that the important one or the main puzzle was taking so long, how you could have solved it, that sort of stuff. So it's not the end of the world. Rightio. Hopefully this was helpful. If you have any other questions, feel free to contact the school at Corindai High School via email, and we're going to be continuing with this process. The next escape room that we're going to be running is going to be a Cold War focused one, so we will be posting that perhaps sometime in the near future. Cool, thanks.